my little 3-year-old son, when we saw a guy driving, and I gave my son 2 euro, and I said, I want you to go up and put that in the cup in front of that man sitting down there. So up she went and said, hello, how are you? What's your name? Freezing cold? How's business? You know, a little bit of small talk. And then she said, look, my son has something he wants to give you. And then he fell in love, he put the 2 euro into the cup. The homeless man put his hand in his pocket, and he took out a Mars bar. And he said, and I have something I want to give your son. Now, what was he responding to there? It wasn't the 2 euro, though he still made a profit. But it was the fact that he was treated as a human being. And that's what it's about, affirming the dignity. People say to me, I won't give the money, I'll buy it instead. And I say, the last thing in the world you should do is buy them a sandwich. How do you know they want a sandwich? And maybe 10 people in the last hour have bought them a sandwich and they're sick of sandwiches. Why don't you go up and ask them what they'd like? And it's the asking that's important, because you're treating them as a person, as a human being. And probably they'd say, well, look, I prefer the money, actually. And I'd say, why don't you give me the 2 euro that you would have spent on a sandwich? And people say, but they're not going to spend it on drugs. I say, so what? If you have a drug problem, you have a drug problem. You're going to get your drugs one way or the other. Or isn't it better they beg for their drug money and go out and rob somebody of his hammer? So I have no problem giving somebody a euro or two, even though I'm pretty sure they may be going to spend it on drugs. So say I've been spending my life working with homeless people. There is no greater satisfaction in life than helping other people. I just feel like people say, how do you keep going doing that for so long? I just feel I've been very lucky. I'm one of the few people in Ireland who really enjoy what I'm doing. I just feel I have been blessed to have been able to work with homeless people. The satisfaction you get out of helping people is second to none. So, thank you very much, and if anybody has questions, please.
Thank you very much. This is your 11th year doing Leaders on a Level. On behalf of Terenure College and everyone organising the event, I'd like to say a big, big thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Set the lights on. I think we're gonna have time for a few questions now. Hands up again. Yeah, just do it. Name your school, please. Just down the front here. Yeah,
wrong. Okay. I'm always like my lady's partner, and how many homes are there around the whole country?
How many homes are there around the whole country? Now, that's a complicated question. Most homeless children, younger children, are actually placed in foster homes, not in residential homes. Some children are placed in residential homes. We have 4 of them. How many are there around the country? I've no idea. Probably about 20 or 30 around the country. But if a very young child can't live in their own home, the next best thing is to live in a foster home, somebody else's home. And if they can't live in a foster home, then they come to a residential home such as ours. And we try and make life as pleasant as possible for them, but it's never the same as growing up in a family. But we do our best, and all the residential homes do their best.
Yep, up the top there, please.
Rachel Kirby from Manor House. Do you feel that the Irish government do enough for the homeless people? And what were your opinions on them setting up the Apollo House?
Do I think the government are doing something? But definitely not enough. I spent a lot of my time criticising the government, a lot of my time writing articles about what the government should be doing and aren't doing. So no, they are definitely not doing enough for homeless people. What do I think of Apollo House? Apollo House was not the solution to homelessness. Apollo House was a 10-story office block, and it's not suitable for accommodating homeless people. However, it did serve a great function while it was open. It highlighted the fact that there are people living in this country, the 14th wealthiest country in the world, people living on the streets. It highlighted that fact. And it highlighted the fact that there are people without homes and there are buildings without people. We could house everybody in this country by Christmas if we wanted to, because there's 198,000 empty houses and apartments all boarded up in this country. 198,000. If I was in the government, I would just go in and compulsorily purchase the land. I would just buy it, take them over, and use them for housing homeless people. So I think, yes, the government have produced a plan. It's the best plan I've seen from government in the 40 years I've been working, but my criticism is it's not enough.
Lucy Keneally, Dundalk Grammar School. How do you propose to teach us as young people how not to automatically judge people and how to eradicate the stigma that's related to people in these situations?
The very good question. I think the only way that can really happen is by personal contact with people, by personal contact with some homeless people, by personal contact with people who are poor or whatever. It's the personal contact. In the personal contact, we all put labels on people. Homeless person, drug addict, drug dealer. We all put labels on people. And the only way to get behind the label is to actually get to know one or two people. And so in our drop-in centre, we have transition year students, some of you have been there, spend a week in our drop-in centre. What do they do there? They just talk and listen to homeless people. But what happens during the week is they get behind the label homeless person, drug addict, drug dealer. And they meet the real person. And they come to realize the real person is exactly the same as you and me. Only their path in life has gone in a totally different direction through no fault of their own. So engage, just go up and speak to some people, some homeless people. Just go up and just have a chat, even just for a minute, 30 seconds, a minute. But even in that, you begin to build a relationship. And the relationship breaks down the stigma that you're talking about. So thank you for the question. Very good question.
There we go, over here to Connor.
I'm Marie Bishop from Ireland School. Would you say that working with homeless people has strengthened or weakened your faith in God?
It has strengthened my faith in God. People often ask me, when you see the horrors that homeless people have experienced in childhood, does that not challenge your faith in God? And I say no. The problems they have experienced in childhood are the fault of us human beings. They're not God's fault. We are the ones who are responsible. The parents and the families are responsible for what has happened to them. But what we have been given by God is a responsibility to do something about it. I haven't time to talk about my image of God, but for me, Jesus had a dream. Jesus had a dream that all of us, every single human being, is a child of God. And Jesus' dream was that we could live, the human race could live, as the family of God. Now, in a family of four children, the parents don't give three of the children a big steak for their dinner and give the fourth child bread and jam. No. In a family of four children, everybody shares whatever food is available. And yet, within the family of God, 1 billion people on our planet go to bed hungry every night. Every one of those 1 billion people is God's beloved child. No parent wants to see their child going to bed hungry every night, and God doesn't want to see God's children going to bed hungry every night. And in a family of four children, the parents don't give three of the children a nice warm bed and tell the fourth child to sleep outside in the dog's kennel. No, whatever rooms are available, everybody shares. And yet in the family of God, in every city in this world, there are people sleeping on the streets. Every one of those people sleeping on the streets is God's beloved child. No parent wants to see their child sleeping on the streets, and God doesn't want to see God's children sleeping on the streets. So Jesus had this dream that the whole human race, everybody could live fulfilled and happy lives. And we do that by caring and sharing for each other. And what makes us Christians is not that we obey certain laws that the church lays down. What makes us Christians is that we share Jesus' dream. The dream of building a world where everybody can live a happy, fulfilled life. Building a world of justice and of peace. And for me, that's my faith in God. God has given me and each one of us the responsibility of trying to build this world into a world that God can be proud of. Building a world in which suffering is reduced. Building a world in which we build up the happiness of every single human being.
I'm afraid that's all the time for today. There is a stand, Peter McVerry Trust has a stand, so if you have any further questions, they'll have information on how you can battle home with us there. Thank you once again, Father Peter.
Thank you very much, Father.
Have our first break now, so please do use this time to get onto social media. We have a lot of exclusive content going on and competitions, and we have stands, Peter McVerry Trust stand, and also the Stein Study stand is running a competition for two longitude tickets. So, we'll see you back in half an hour.